Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Aichi Petrochemical Limited. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on date of this call. These statements are not guarantees of future performance and involve risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Pramod Bhandari, CFO of Aichi Petrochemical Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, dear friends. Myself, Pramod Bhandari, CFO of Aichi Petrochemical. On the behalf of Aichi Petrochemical, I extend a very warm welcome to every one of you to join us for the call today. I hope you and your loved ones are safe and doing well. On this call, we are joined by SGA, our investor relations advisor. I hope everyone has got opportunity to go through the financial results and the investor presentation, which has been uploaded on the stock exchange as well as the company's website. Since some of you may be hearing Aichi Petrochemical conference first time, we would like to give you a quick overview about the company, followed by the operational and financial performance. IGPL is a three-decade-old organization, a part of the renowned Dhanuka Group. We are India's largest producer and world's third-largest producer of phthalic anhydride. It is a versatile intermediate in the organic chemistry and a downstream product of ortho-xylene, which is a basic petrochemical product. We have four phthalic plant, four maleic plant, and three benzoic acid facilities at Taloja, Maharashtra. Our facilities are engineered by the technical collaboration with the Lurgi, Germany. We serve more than 100 clients, and our product has application in more than 20 end-user industries. Although more than 50% of our business contributed from the end-user industries like paint, plasticizers, CPC, pigments, consumption of PA in other end-user industries like specialty chemicals is rising due to the inventive use as compared to the few years back. Post our PA4 expansion plant of 53,000 tons, which has started the commercial production in December 2020, we have largest capacity of 222,000 tons of phthalic anhydride at single location in the world. We also produce maleic anhydride and the benzoic acid, which are the derivative after the production of PAN through the wastewater, wash water. Today, we have a capacity of 7,600 tons of the maleic anhydride and 1,300 of the benzoic acid. PA4 plant achieved their optimum capacity at Q1 FY22, which is the last quarter. The expanded capacity has given a thrust to the growth trajectory of the company and the full benefit of which will be visible in upcoming year. We have also set up the effluent treatment plant that will enable us to achieve our zero liquid discharge facility for the entire plant, which house four phthalic, four maleic, three benzoic acid plant. IGPL has embarked the growth plan in view of the demand growth in the downstream derivatives and Government of India continuous focus on the building Indian infrastructure. In relation to the phthalic and maleic market, IGPL is one of the largest producer in the global market, has more than 50% market share in India. Market size for the PAN phthalic anhydride in the domestic is around 450,000-475,000 tons, which roughly 80%-85% are supplied by the domestic players and 20%-25% is through import. PAN market is anticipated to register a CAGR to 8% in next 5-8 years due to the rising demand of the PVC due to increase in the infrastructure spend from the government, increasing uses of the glass fiber-reinforced polymers, which we call FRP, growing consumption of alkylate resin in the paints and coating industry for improved corrosion and the thermal resistance in the automotive and the construction industry, rising popularity of the lightweight automotive parts in the vehicle to improve fuel efficiency is expected to further promote the industry growth for the UPR, which in turn requires the phthalic. All our factors are expected to drive the PAN demand going forward. IGPL capacity expansion or entry into the downstream segment has opened a new window of opportunity for the IGPL to get into the downstream specialty chemicals. In relation to the maleic anhydride, we are the only manufacturer in India, which we have around 10%-15% market share. Balance 85% is served through the import. there is an ample of opportunity for the domestic player like IGPL to substitute the imports. Increasing demand for the UPR, BDO will drive the market going forward for the maleic anhydride. These chemicals are widely used in the engineering plastics, fibers, medicines, artificial leather, cosmetics, pesticides, hardeners, plasticizers, solvents, and rust removers. In terms of the competitive edge, we are the one of the lowest cost producer of the phthalic due to the strategic location, which is near to the raw material supplier, as well as the port, which is catering to the domestic as well as the international customers. Our operating efficiency with the good cash flow from the operations place IGPL in a very comfortable position to venture into the new chemistry in the downstream segment. As a part of our vision to diversify our product portfolio, IGPL continue to explore the opportunity in downstream derivatives and other specialty projects. Being the market leader with a strong technical expertise, we foresee huge opportunity with the rising demand for PEN in multiple end user industries. In terms of the greenfield expansion, in view of the surge in the demand of the PEN across all the sectors, mainly paint, plasticizer, specialty chemicals, pigments, the expansion will increase our capacity and derivatives by 80,000 tons and expected to complete in 3 years. More than 50% will go into downstream and balance 50% will be used in domestic and the global customers' requirement. Our expansion plan, which we have announced last quarter, is on track. In terms of the specialty plasticizers, advanced specialty plasticizers, which we have already in the process of implementation, expected to complete in this quarter. Specialty plasticizers is used because of a good rising demand into end-user industries like incense sticks, cosmetics, formulation, toiletries, plastics, and all that. So once we add this unit, we are expected to add another 70 to 80 crores in terms of the annualized revenue in the company. In terms of the term loan and working capital, as you are aware that last quarter we have already announced that we have paid 62 crore of our project term loan, which we have taken for the PA4 unit. Out of that, 42 crore was the prepayment. So net debt position of the company as on today is around 40 crore. Gross debt is 110 crore. Cash roughly lying in balance sheet is over 70 crore. We intend to become a zero debt company in the calendar year, at the end of calendar year 2021. We also have reconfigured our working capital facility with the induction of the HDFC Bank, Standard Chartered Bank, and Qatar National Bank. This will help us further reduce our banking and financial cost. Way forward, our long-term vision is to be a well-diversified chemical company with a leadership position in phthalic industry. We wish to diversify our product portfolio by getting into the other downstream derivatives industries and other specialty chemical to achieve our vision to achieve 2025 to have at least 30% of our revenue from non-phthalic product. We will continue to focus on delivering profitable growth along with the investment in expansion, timely project execution, and with operational excellence. We are well placed to sustain our growth in FY22, on track to achieve our long-term objective to increase our business from downstream derivative products. In terms of the financial performance for Q1 FY22, total revenue of the company and other income stood at 389 crore, which is strictly not comparable with the corresponding previous quarter because at that time there was a lockdown announced by the government and plant was shut for around 30 to 40 days. However, if you compare it with the growth of 172% on year-to-year basis due to the healthy demand in domestic international market, we have done change in the catalyst and performed some of the repair work at PA2 unit in the last quarter, which resulted into a production loss of around 10%, which is roughly 5,000 tons. We have incurred extra repair and maintenance expenditure because of the change in catalyst of around 600 crore in this last quarter. Revenue contribution in terms of the domestic market is 80%, 20% is on account of the exports. Performance for the quarter is not comparable due for the last quarter, sequential quarter, because last quarter was exceptional quarter, which happened once in 8 to 10 years. It was a good backlog demand as well as exceptionally high margin. EBITDA on quarter to quarter corresponding quarter basis has grown 411% to 85 crore. Operating margin at healthy at 22%. Margin on year-to-year basis was better, primarily due to the optimal capacity utilization, post-expansion, and better product mix. Profit after tax stand at 52 crore, which is a healthy growth compared to year-to-year basis. The next quarter, which is the current quarter, looks to be healthy and good, with optimum utilization of capacity for all the four plants and gradually rising in the demand in the Indian market post the COVID. We see that there will be good traction of the demand in the coming quarter. So in terms of the final remark, India is currently a net importer of phthalic and malic. Around 25% of phthalic and around 85% of malic is imported in India. There is ample room for import substitution. With our new capacity expansion, technical expertise, we are well equipped to garner these opportunities. With this, I would like to conclude this call. If you have any query, please contact SGA, our investor relations advisor. Thank you very much for joining call. I would like to conclude the presentation, open the floor for further discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one at this time. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Aditya Khitan from Stewart and Marketage. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon,
Aditya. Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, my first question is, in this quarter, sir, gross margin sequentially has witnessed around 1,000 basis point contraction. So what is the major reason? Is it because of the higher OX prices or higher raw material inventory?
So let me explain you in the three ways how it happens. So first, if you remember in the last quarter, we mentioned that it is an exceptional quarter. The profits and the margin earned by the company is exceptional because of the backlog demand, because of the COVID, as well as the higher margin because of the global issues in terms of the freight and other issues. So when you compare this quarter to the last quarter, it is sequentially not correct because of the three reasons. First, we have taken a shutdown of around 25 days for our PA2 unit for change in catalyst. So one, it results into the loss of production. And second, it has incurred the extra expenditure of 6 to 8 crore, which for the purpose of change in catalyst, we need to do the repair and maintenance work. Secondly, compared to the last quarter, when the margin was exceptionally high, if you see, there is a moderation in the margin, which we already indicated. The margin in the last quarter was exceptionally high. It is not possible that to sustain forever. It's better to take $200 and $250 margin, which is the last quarter margin, which we have concluded recently, to take as an average of next 4 to 5 years. Previous quarter was very high, $300 to $400, that we have indicated. The second reason, which I've already mentioned about the loss of production. And third is because of that extra expenditure we have made. In terms of one side, we lost the production, and second side, we need to incur the extra expenditure. And let me tell you, this is not unusual, but every time we have four plants, every year there will be a shutdown for one or two plants for change in catalyst, because our catalyst is used once in 3 to 4 years. So generally April, May, June, or July, August, September, we take the shutdown for change in catalyst.
So got your point, but on the gross margins, if we take the other expenses, you are correct that 6 to 8 crore extra cost you are taking. But on the gross side, we are witnessing some steep contraction around 1,000 basis points. So is it because of the higher raw material pricing?
I think you are comparing the Q4 versus Q1, which is not correct comparison.
Yes.
It is not correct comparison, because I told you that Q4 was exceptionally high. $400, $500 per ton is not possible. It happens once in 8 to 10 years. General margin, which is prevalent right now, is $200 to $250. And that is the basis we need to take for the purpose of the making the financial model or taking the projections. So,
we had done around $200 to $250 per ton.
No, the market margin was around $200 to $250. Company, if you take the financial number, it is coming around $400 to $410.
Okay.
Market is around $200 to $250.
Okay.
But some production loss and extra money which we have spent. The best part of the quarter is our malic and nitrate, which we have started along with phthalic, is generating good revenue. The last quarter revenue was around 18 crore, which is annualized. We are expected to have 80 crore revenue from the malic and venture capital. That will directly contribute to the EBITDA margin.
Okay. Yes. Sir, in the recent, if we take the month of June and July, because of the higher crude prices moving to around $70-$75, we had seen a good movement in the ortho-xylene prices also. So do you think so this could be an effect going ahead on the margins, considering the PAN prices are not moving that much on the higher side?
There are two ways. One side, raw material prices increase. Second side, there is a contraction in the demand because India just passes through in April, May, the cold second. And similar thing happened across the globe. So there is a reduction in the margin. There is no second thought on that. From 350 to 400, it has gone down to 200 to 50. Now, in the current quarter, we are seeing the improvement in the margin as well as very good improvement in demand. Because India just passed it through in April, May, if you remember that second COVID wave. It was not actually lockdown, but there is a contraction in the demand in domestic as well as the international market. When you see the other markets in Middle East and also, they were sucked. So gradually demand is going up and accordingly margin will be improved.
Okay. So volumes for the quarter, if you can share, sir, or the utilization figure.
Generally, we avoid sharing the volume, but typically 17,000 to 17,500 is the monthly average. So on that basis, you can calculate 10% is the reduction because there was a change in the catalyst.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sir, just one more question.
On the newly coming
expansion of 80,000 tons, so almost 50% we would be making phthalic anhydride only, and remaining 50% we would use it for the downstream product. So have you all outlined any of the downstream derivative products, like apart from
80,000 tons is phthalic, out of that 50% will be used for the downstream. It is under finalization, but right now it has not been discussed, analyzed, and gone to the board. So I will not be able to disclose this, what is the downstream we are coming up. But 50% or more than 50% will be used in downstream, and balance will be used in domestic and international market.
Okay, so plan has not yet been, so it is in the initial stages only as of.
No, plan is finalized, but you know that in India, it takes around 9 months to get the environmental approval. You take a lot of time. So let everything settle, and then we will be able to disclose the identity of downstream derivatives. Right now, we are just completing the advanced plasticizer, advanced specialty plasticizer, which will be, I think, expected to go online in this quarter, maybe August end or September first week.
Okay. Sir, just one more question on the plasticizers only. So I believe, so this unit of plasticizer of around 8,400 tons, so this would be a pilot project only. So are you all planning to like go ahead and take a big jump in the advanced plasticizers also?
I will not say it's a pilot project. Of course, you can always come up with the bigger plasticizer capacity, but after our discussion and survey in the market, we believe it's not normal plasticizer, it's a specialty plasticizer which will be used in instant steaks and all type of toiletries. So market demand, in terms of the market side, it will be covering 50% of the market, the specialty plasticizers.
Okay.
Of that segment. So it is not a commodity, it's like a specialty plasticizer. Our total revenue typically was 100% phthalic. Now with this specialty plasticizer, we have 9% revenue from malic anhydride, benzoic acid, and specialty plasticizer going forward.
Okay. Got it. Thank you, sir. I'll join back in.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you may press star and one to ask a question at this time. The next question is from the line of Ananda Padmanabhan from PGIM India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thanks for taking my question. Sir, I missed your comments with regard to the production loss because of the catalyst change. What would have been the total production loss, or what would have been the sequential decline in volumes because of this catalyst change, shutdown taken for catalyst change?
10% of the total production for the quarter.
Okay, and that is something that would recover in the second quarter.
Correct.
And the second part is with regard to the spreads. You mentioned that the spreads in the market are $200 to $250. What is the kind of premium that the company is commanding on this spread?
No. Actually, the company is commanding the premium because of 2-3 factors. If you look at the better operating efficiency, which give us the better yield, that is the one reason. Second, our downstream product like malic anhydride and benzoic acid, that has added. Plus, if you compare with the import parity, the freight, transportation, insurance, All these three factors added to the market, international market margin in terms of the company's margin.
What is the, if you could give any some in terms of any number or what is the typical spread that company typically commands?
It generally vary quarter to quarter, but typically based on the last quarter number, I can say between 100-150.
100-150.
Yeah.
From Q4 to Q1, you mentioned that the demand of the spreads have normalized.
Correct.
This Q1 gross margin that you have reported is a normalized gross margin or Q2 would be a more reasonable comparison for a normalized gross margin?
There are two, three reasons for the Q1 to impact. First, there is a certainly moderation of margin because in India also there was a second wave of the COVID. Second, we have change in the catalyst. Because of that, there is a production loss. Third, there is extra expenditure. Margin, I believe, is stabilized now and slightly improving. If there is no global threat in terms of the COVID, I expect margin to stabilize and going towards the upward side. Because right now also a lot of countries are impacted. When a country is impacted and getting the shutdown, ultimately it affects the demand for the phthalic, which resulted into overall decline in the global market. We are making over and above that. That is separate thing. I am saying global margin has to be strong or moderate. Right now from early last quarter, it has already been moderated and corrected because of the COVID. I believe the COVID situation with the vaccination drive going in India and other developed countries, it should moderate and go down. Probably next 3 to 6 months it will be 90% should go out, but I am not a doctor in that. If COVID recede, which I believe it will be, then you can see a healthy margin in the phthalic.
Okay. At least in terms of your guidance that you're giving for the rest of the year, are expecting the spreads to, the market spreads to normalize between $200-$250?
I will not give you the guidance for the year, but I can surely tell you that if you take the next 4 to 5 year average, it should be between $200-$250.
Okay.
Maybe more than that.
I understand.
This is the last 5-year average. Because I don't know what is going to happen in terms of the COVID, probably next quarter or next to next quarter. That's why I avoid giving quarter-to-quarter guidance. I give next 4 to 5 years, that is the average you can take.
Okay. With regard to your planned expansion and your plans to go into downstream products, so that could, do you expect, in terms of the product selection, would it also be a function of the kind of products that your clients are into? Because in case you get into downstream, you'd be directly competing with your clients, and that could impact the base of your business. Or is there a-
Generally, we are not getting into-
Impact that.
We are not getting into any product which is generally available. We wanted to go into downstream specialty derivatives only, which is generally not produced or produced by a very handful of the players. Right now it is not right for me to discuss or disclose about that. Let board approve this, then we will come up with this. Because in India, you know that a lot of times is taken for the land final approval in terms of the environmental and all of that. It is time taking, but we are trying to accelerate the entire process.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I'll get back into the queue.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jainam Ghelani from Moneybee Advisors. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. This is Manan here from Moneybee.
Hi, Manan.
Can you just throw some light on the imports, and what is the trend over there, and is there a decreasing trend, and how is the demand looking going forward?
Last quarter there was some decline in the demand, but now the demand has come up strongly after the second wave of COVID. I think most of the India has now opened up except select set of a particular area. Demand is going good. In terms of the overall margin, I think it is expected to moderate or improve. Right now it has started improving.
Okay.
So that demand side there is no worry because India today also typically import around 15-20%. Roughly India is now importing around 40,000-45,000 per quarter right now. Last quarter there was a decline because there was a second wave of COVID. It was 35-36. But still, if you look at 120,000 to 140,000 tons is imported by India.
Okay.
And that has to be required because overall demand is 470-475. We produce roughly 2 lakh to 2 lakh 10 thousand. Other player probably doing 130 to 140, both put together, still India is a deficit by 1 lakh ton. So that is the one part, import continue to happen.
With our pricing, since the freight costs have spiked and, you know,
yeah, that is another reason for the better margin in the domestic market. The freight cost in the international market has gone up by 2.5 to 3 times. Typically, when the typically from the Korean and other, earlier it was $50 to $60, now it's $150 to $160. So freight and a lot of issues in the international containers, other logistics issues, that has also given the thrust to the domestic player. So that is from demand side. In India, there are a lot of new industries are being added, like specialty chemicals. A lot of new industries are requiring the phthalic for the purpose of other specialty chemicals and other chemicals. So not only the existing clients are increasing their capacity because of the...
Have we added any new client in the past 6 months?
We have added 2 to 3 new clients in terms of the new industry. But there is no discussion we can have on the call. Yeah, we have added the new clients, but we have further diversified our client base from earlier. Earlier, we were supplying to 15, 16, now more than 20 industries. Existing clients all are expanding their capacity. There is a good amount of capacity expansion in paint and the plasticizers because the government has given, if you are coming up with a new company, 17% tax rate, then there is no sunset clause. But a lot of clients are also getting the basically production incentive. So their effective tax rate is very low. So everybody is expanding not only to cater to the domestic market, but also to export market. If all downstreams are growing and new sectors are being added, so you can always believe there is a great demand. And Indian infrastructure, the phthalic demand is directly linked with the Indian infrastructure. If Indian infrastructure is bound to grow by 8 to 10%, you will see the similar growth in the phthalic going forward.
Okay. And then just coming to this catalyst now, since we have now 4 units, and these catalysts are required to be changed every 4 years, is what I understand. So ideally, there would be this catalyst expense annually, right?
Yeah, yeah, 100%. Yes.
For each and every unit, and annually we'll have around...
Let me explain you. We have 4 phthalic units. Every year, there will be a 1 or sometime 3 and 4 years, 2 units. Because generally in 3 years, 3.5 years, we change the catalyst. So every year, generally April, May, June, or July, August, September is the period when there is a change in the catalyst for the 1 unit. Every year, there will be 1 unit change in the catalyst for the company.
Is it ideal to take it in, during Q1 as demand moderation is there during generally Q1?
I think generally we take in the Q1 or Q2 because that is the time then, because in the raining season, we believe there is a generally moderation in the demand. So generally in the raining season, we take. And along with that change in the catalyst, we also do the repair and maintenance work for the unit. So both the things goes together.
Right. So ideally, it's better to take it during this time as loss of sale would be lower as our customers
and
also
in,
would be.
In raining season, generally, there is a lower demand of the paints and other industry. So it's better to take it in that time.
Okay. Thank you. I'll get back in the queue.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Atul Kothari from Procwell Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for the opportunity. So my query is, first of all, how has maleic anhydride price moved over the quarter?
So maleic anhydride is actually very good price. Maleic anhydride is between 110 to 125 rupees per kg. Which is compared to the phthalic is 30-40% higher than phthalic price. And last quarter also, it was a similar price.
Okay. And so how much revenue was generated on account of maleic anhydride in Q1 FY22?
In Q1, it was 18 crore. However, at full, it has to be ideally 20 crore. But because there was a shutdown for 1 unit for 1 month, so it was 18 crore for the Q1 FY22.
Okay. And so how much revenue can we expect from maleic anhydride?
We are expecting an annualized basis, if there is no shutdown, around 80 crore rupee revenue has to be there from maleic anhydride. And the interesting part is that whatever is the revenue of the maleic, since there is a no raw material is used, whatever is the revenue directly added to the EBITDA for the maleic anhydride.
Okay, great. And sir, how is the demand supply trend for maleic anhydride and benzoic acid?
Benzoic acid is a very small portion, maybe 5 to 6 crore in a year. For maleic anhydride, India has demand of around 70 to 75,000 tons, and now it is growing at 8 to 10%. IG Petrochemical is producing roughly 7 to 7,500 tons, so balance 85% is imported by India. So in terms of demand, that is not a challenge because everything is imported by India.
Okay, okay. So basically the demand supply is a little bit stretched right now. That's what you would like
it's
to say?
Always stressed, because you only IG, which is producing 7,500 tons, 65 to 70,000 tons is imported by India.
Okay.
It's always the case because nobody else is producing right now.
Okay. And sir, which key user industries normally drive the growth for us in domestic market?
I think, let me explain you, because we are supplying to more than 20 to 25 industries. Actually, if you look at the scenario, every quarter there are different industries. Like sometimes plasticizer is high, in raining paint is low. So it is like recalibrating, every quarter industries are recalibrating. So specifically, if you talk about which industry is high, it is not possible to pin out, because every quarter there is a different industry which is driving the growth. But if you look at on overall yearly basis, I think paint and plasticizer cover major chunk of around 40-45%.
Okay. So the 40-45% of our revenue comes from the end user industry of paints. That's what you would like to say, right?
Paints, plasticizers and pigments. All three put together. Yeah, they are the major contributors.
And so the remaining 55%? Approximately from which industry?
There are paints, plasticizers, pigments, UPR, PVC pipes. There are n number of industries.
More than
20.
Okay, sir.
FRP, and a lot of new guys. Like right now, specialty chemical is new entrant in last 1 year. A lot of specialty chemical guys are now looking, when they are getting into the other chemistry, they are looking for phthalic anhydride as a part of their raw material cost. This is growing very well.
Okay. And sir, can you spell out as to what was the export export constituted, how much percent of our revenue in FY22, in Q1 FY22?
I already mentioned in my speech, it was 20%. Because there was a moderation in demand in domestic market because of the second wave of COVID. So we have made 20% export, 80% domestic market, compared to Q4 when it was 90 versus 10.
Okay, and sir, how much can we expect for the entire year, FY22?
Typically, I think it's better to expect 15% to 20% exports, 75 to 80% in domestic market.
Okay, sir. And sir, my last question, sir, how much revenue do we expect from the advanced plasticizer business?
So based on the today's prices, on annualized basis, we are expecting 70 to 80 crore to add into our revenue.
Okay.
20 to
30
crore per annum basis.
Okay, sir. And sir, is the margin better in pyrrolidic anhydride and maleic anhydride?
So you need to understand that advanced plasticizer, 65% raw material is phthalic, and then is 2EH, which is the other product which goes 65-35 ratio. Okay. Over and above the phthalic, it will add 15 to 18% margin.
Okay, sir. Okay.
I'm talking about average. Right now, I think 12 to 15% is going on. Once we start, then we will be able to give you the better guidance. Right now, we don't want to offer because we are just in the process of completion of that plant and starting the commercial production. Today's pricing basis, it will be adding 70 to 80 crore on the overall revenue.
Okay, sir. And sir, just one last question. Sir, when it comes to pyrrolidic anhydride, can you throw some color on the end user industry for pyrrolidic anhydride?
It is called phthalic anhydride. The end user is paint, plasticizers, pigments, PVC, specialty chemicals. It goes into the pigment. It goes into the UPR. It goes into FRP. There are multiple industries. In fact, if you look at wherever there is a molding of plastic, like PVC pipes, it's phthalic. It's a pigment, it's phthalic. Look at paint. Okay. In fact, if you look at the dashboard of a car, the molding is because of phthalic. A lot of equipments are also used for the purpose of phthalic. A lot of equipment so as to lighten the weight, so as to improve.
Okay, sir.
Overall efficiency and efficiency in terms of the average of the vehicle.
Sure, sir. So that was very helpful, sir. Thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from Manav Munzal Shah from Edha Wealth LLP. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
One question was from industry perspective. Historically, like we have seen big volatility, in the industry, actually, in terms of performance.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is some prospect of, I think so, and duty also coming into picture. Okay, so if you can throw highlight, like, you know, what is the industry doing wherein the volatility of performance will reduce, or it will still remain as volatile as we have seen historically?
So, yeah, I understood your question. So let me address you in two parts. First, this is a commodity chemical. It is, the margins are driven based on the demand and supply in the global market. So if there is a good demand of all the infrastructure players where the demand is good, you'll see the better upgradation in the margin. If there is an issue, like most of the cities, if you ask me today, the cities in the China are cut because of the COVID and because of a lot of other regions, the demand has been moderated. It's not just because of China, a lot of shutdown because of the COVID period. If you see the Q4 margin was very good, but suddenly the COVID second or third wave in the different part of the geography has come up. So basically it's a demand and supply which drive the margin. Now coming to the second part of the duty. Last, there is a volatility which you have seen because a lot of players, basically let me give you an example. Last 4-5 years what happened? Margins were good. And suddenly you will see that there is a tension between the US and the China because of the trade policy and all that. Because of that, US has stopped buying from China, and China is manufacturing a lot of goods which is using phthalic anhydride as a raw material. So there is a moderation in the demand from the Chinese side. A lot of global suppliers which were supplying to China, they started supplying to across the globe. So it creates somewhere imbalance. Then you see there is a sudden dip in the margin. When the equation improved between China and US, the demand suddenly come up, margin has gone up, then you have seen the COVID has come up. So a lot of events, geopolitical issues, demand supply issues, particularly shutdown in some of the plants. So it is a commodity chemical. It is not expected to behave in a very, very thin range of say 20-30%. It's a commodity chemical, like similar case for the petrol, diesel, if you go for the metal also, it is a commodity chemical which runs in the cycle. Now, let's look at the Indian market now. In India, there is a demand, good amount of demand. Whatever India is producing, which cater around 70-75%, ultimately, in order to keep the Indian industry running and thrive, they have to import around 20% of the product. In India, there is an advantage of the, basically, if you are selling in India, you can supply the product in 2-3 days to your customer. So there is a lesser amount of volatility, lower amount of the inventory gain or loss. Generally, doesn't happen because you are buying the raw material in 2-3 days, you are supplying in 4-5 days. If somebody is importing, they need to take not only the freight, insurance, transportation, of course, now the duty has been introduced, duty and risk, plus the foreign exchange risk. So it is more and more difficult to import in that sense because there are a lot of other variable factors. Right now, the factor which is the dominant is the container rates of freight, which is around $50 earlier, now it's $150 to $160. It's not for telling. Across globe, all commodity movement, the freight rate has gone 2-3 times. So there are a lot of other factors which play. Now coming to a specific question, Indian versus the international market. Indian market gives some additional advantage over and above the international market, but to say that Indian market is impacting the global margin is not correct because total consumption in India is 5% of the global. So there are a lot of global factors which determine the margin, which determine the margin. However, there are some additional advantage in terms of this, which is production in India.
And sir, anything on the anti-dumping duty, when is the case likely to be taken, and you know, any dates that you have been given, sir?
So anti-dumping duty, that matter has been recommended by the, I think, Commerce Ministry. I would not like to comment, it's lying with the Finance Ministry. But generally, I don't think anti-dumping duty has any much specific impact on the phthalic side. Because generally, the guys who are buying based on the EOU and all that, they are able to buy under the advanced license where they need to incur the zero duty. If somebody is buying for the purpose of exporting, there is no impact of anti-dumping duty.
And sir, both on the malic and PAN, okay, could you throw some highlight, like 20-25% is import, and in case of malic, almost 80-85% is import.
Correct.
Which two or three countries are the major exporters to India?
It's basically the Korea, Taiwan, they are the major. Somewhere, some other countries, but Korea, Taiwan are the major ones.
Of PAN or both?
PAN. Malik, I think India is buying Malik across the globe because India is 85% deficit.
Huh. So, but there is no concentration of imports?
No, no. Generally in Thalic, China generally do some export, but they do import because China is net deficit of Thalic. So there is hardly anything bigger quantity coming, but I think Korea, Taiwan, and these side of the countries, they are exporting earlier to China, now to India also.
So if I have to again summarize, like if I take a next 5-year view, okay, your container rates would stabilize at some point of time and they would go back from $150 to say $50.
Yeah.
Okay. And again, there will be a free movement of.
That is why I suggest that let's not look at all the abnormalities going on because there is a moderation in demand because of phthalic, higher container rate. There are a lot of other issues. So assume a scenario where there is no COVID, everything is normalized. I believe in view of the existing demand in the global market, 200 and 250 for next 5-year average is perfectly fine.
Okay. Okay, $200 to $250 per ton.
In international market, yeah.
Of PAN.
Of PAN.
And as you mentioned, Malik enjoys roughly 30% more margins. Is that right?
Malik right now is 30% to 35% over and above Thalic.
Yeah.
Right.
So
now. Yeah.
If PAN is say 200, 250 for 5-year average,
Malik you can always say two.
Malik will be 25-30% more than that. Mean
that is right now going on, but typically it's 10-15%. Right now it's 25-30%.
Okay, fine. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one. Ladies and gentlemen, you may press star and one to ask a question at this time. The next question is from the line of Shanti Patel from Shanti Patel Investment. Please go ahead.
Sir, my question is looking to the present scenario as you explained to us that container freight has gone up, the demand situation is improving, and et cetera, meaning thereby that next quarter will be much better than what we saw in the current result in the current quarter.
I would not like to give you any future guidance, but it looks to be better.
No, I mean, looking to the situation, the various factors. Which
I understand your point where I'm coming from, but I again insist in the commodity chemical, it's better not to look quarter to quarter. It's better to look 1 year or 2 year average.
So suppose we have to look from 1 year, what you can you give some indication?
If you take 200 to 250 margin, dollar per ton, you will be able to come up with a margin for a company which is sustainable.
Okay.
In one quarter, you may be making in the market, there are 300, 400. In one quarter, it will be 150. It's better to take the average. And then you can easily calculate. Yeah.
I understand. It is a fluctuating, so it is very difficult quarter to quarter, but it gets average out over a period of 1 year.
That is the reason we avoid giving any guidance for next 2 years. Being IGPL, a company which we have diversified now, so you will see that Malik and Rider is contributing around 80 crore rupees. Benzo gas is 4 to 5, plasticizer will be more and more you are getting into the other downstream. You will see the stability in the EBITDA and margin. Phthalic may be fluctuating, but other products which will keep the EBITDA and the gross margin levels stable compared to the historical number.
Okay. What is our capacity utilization in respect of all these verticals?
We are continuing to have 90-95% capacity utilization. This is the standard capacity utilization across the globe.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rahul, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, Pramod.
Hi.
Just wanted to check on the certification regime which is undergoing the BIS certification. It's got pushed by another 6 months, I think. It's going all the way into December now. How do you have any idea of who all have been already certified or what's in progress? Because I assume at some point it will get live. It was supposed to happen a year back, but it's not yet. So is there any intelligence around any major competitor?
Not exactly, but I understand that because of the COVID situation, there is no finalization from the government side. They were busy in other matters. So they keep on postponing that because of the COVID, first wave, second wave. Right now, they're also grappling. Now, I think we understand that it is going to finalize, provided there is no COVID around now. Because you never know what is the situation is going to be in the next 3 to 4 months. But I assume if there is no COVID situation, it is expected to finalize soon now.
Right. Just a follow-up question on this one is, purely from an external market perspective, I would assume on the phthalic side, the spreads are the most meaningful contributor. So is there anything else that I understand the internal efficiencies, capacity utilization, etc. But from an external market, is there anything else that's a key monitorable on the phthalic side apart from the ortho-octylene and phthalic spread?
I think apart from the spread, you can look at the growth in the various sectors which contribute to the economy, which is paint, plasticizer, UPR, pigment, PVC, car sales. If they all are growing, which is the part of Indian economy or infrastructure, phthalic demand continue to grow. And not only in India, in the global market also. So that will be the big thrust. And a lot of new industries are added where phthalic will be supplied as a raw material. So phthalic, there are a lot of things which is happening in the phthalic, but right now it is not in India. Like, let me give you one example. We called it a FRP, which is a type of product. All the infrastructure in the global market, in US market, in Europe market, all the pipes, underground pipelines are of the FRP, UPR and FRP base. So it has a life of 180 to 100 years. There is no corrosion. In India, the entire infrastructure of underground pipeline is of metal, which corroded in 30 to 40 years. India needs to change it everything. But when it will be, when government will decide about that, then you will see the phthalic demand continuously growing from 15 to 20%. So there are a lot of factors we determine. In India, we are very niche in stage of usage of phthalic in UPR, specialty chemicals, because in global market it's 20 to 25%. In India, 1% of the total phthalic goes into that. So there are a lot of factors. How Indian infrastructure grow, how government will formulate the policy, that will also drive the demand apart from the infrastructure spend.
That's very useful. Just a last question from my end. While there's a lot of capacity which is coming up in India amongst IG and its competitors and also one of its customers, is there any, from a larger geographical perspective, do you see any other capacity coming up in Asia, or conversely, do you see anything going out? Is there any closures, I mean, on either side?
I think I don't see any capacity coming up, except I think one small 2030, which I heard in coming up in Korea or Taiwan. There is no other capacities coming up. Of course, in India, because there is a good demand and infrastructure demand is expected to grow around 8 to 10% for next 20 years. And phthalic demand is also expected to grow. If you say the phthalic will go at 7 to 8% of today's demand, which is roughly 35 to 40. In next 5 years, India will be looking at the good demand, and there has to be somebody who is producing that. So we continue to maintain our leadership position and continue to add the capacity based on the domestic demand. Other players also will continue to look at that option from the point of view of how demand is panning out in India.
Right. Very helpful. Thanks a lot, Pramod.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraints, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Pramod Bhandari for closing comments.
So friends, you know that India is currently net importer of phthalic, and probably next 3 years that net import will continuously increase till some new plant is coming up. 20 to 25% in phthalic and 80 to 85% in the maleic. Hence, there is ample room for the import substitution with new capacity expansion. Technical experts, we are well equipped to garner this opportunity. With this, I will conclude this call. If you have any query, you can contact SGA, our investor relations advisor. Thank you very much for joining us today in the earnings. Stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. On behalf of IG Petrochemicals Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.